Okay, ladies and gentlemen, why don't we get started? The bad news is I don't have an opening joke for tonight. The good news is I don't have an opening joke for tonight. So, but I did think of something. I'm not sure it's so funny, but I always say that. So, this is today we're going to be speaking about Eastern Europe, specifically Ukraine in the 17th century. So I have kind of like a late Tsarist period, late 19th century joke. It goes like this. There's a Jew who gets on a train. He's traveling from Minsk to Pinsk, and sitting in these compartments with these wooden chairs and so on, and he has his lunch packed with him, and he's sitting and he's eating some herring, and bursts into the room a kind of a rowdy peasant with, obviously been drinking quite a bit, and sees the opportunity to sit and talk to a Jew. So he sits down and says, "Hey, Jew, what is it that makes you people so smart?" You know, it's very difficult for this small, peddler to avoid the attentions of this peasant in the room with him. So, he doesn't know quite what to say. He says, "Well, we have a special diet, and it's what we eat that contributes to our intelligence." So the peasant seems, satisfied with that answer for a few minutes, and he says, "So Jew, what exactly do you eat that makes you so smart?" And the Jew, he doesn't know what to say, so he says, "Well, for example, we have this herring that we eat, and the herring, it really contributes to our overall intelligence." So the peasant thinks for a minute and says, "Jew, how much would you accept for a piece of that herring you're eating? This is the herring you're eating right now, isn't it? How much you accept?" And the Jew says, no, I can't. It's my lunch," and so on. "So I'll give you a ruble. I'll give you 5 rubles. I'll give you 10 rubles for a piece of herring." Finally, the Jew says, "Okay, fine." So he gives him the herring for 10 rubles, and the peasant, immediately begins eating it, and he's eating it, and he says, "Wait a second. This isn't special herring. This tastes just like regular herring. It's not going to make me smarter." And the Jew says, "You see, it's working already." Okay. It's not such a funny joke, but...
Oh,
well, I appreciate it. I don't know. That's a joke that's easily to tell with an ethnic slur, so I'm trying very hard to de-ethnicize it. The peasant in this story, for example, is Jewish as well. But no, I can't say that. But we'll edit this out of the final version, I'm sure. Okay, today's discussion is not it's not a very happy topic. We're going to look specifically at the horrible massacres of the mid-17th century. The Khmelnytsky rebellion and the horrific pogroms that occurred in that context of the Ukrainian revolution against their Polish overlords. So we're going to have a lot of discussion about the nature of this kind of communal violence that has its roots in the kind of antipathy that I outlined in this small humorous episode. And it's not necessarily a happy story, but nevertheless, I'm not a rabbi, this is not a sermon, so I'm just discussing some of the aspects of Jewish history, whether it is positive or not. I would like to mention to you that I'm trying a little bit of an experiment with how I communicate with my students. As many of you know, there are several thousand people who watch this class every week around the world, which is kind of a strange feeling because we have, a small intimate group here, but there's a huge internet audience out there. And I'm going to discontinue for the time being my direct emails because I'm not sure they really do what I need to. If you would like to receive word about upcoming classes and just stay on top of what's happening, find out when the classes get posted to the web, please go to my website, jewishhistorylectures.org. You can also Google my name and you'll probably find me that way. And then on the top right of the screen, there's a little box that says, "Follow this blog via email." Put your email address in there. It'll send you a little confirmation note. You click yes. And you'll get one or two emails a week that are mildly irritating. You can forward them to your former friends. And they'll just let you know what's happening with class. If you prefer, I'm also using Twitter and Facebook as ways to broadcast the class. So if you prefer those means of staying in touch, they're also available on the homepage. And it's easy to unsubscribe as well. There's no commitments. If you feel that there's too much spam, then you just want to get off, then you just go straight to place.
Somebody doesn't have a computer.
If you don't have a computer, then we post the lecture dates on the flyer. We have some flyers at the back of the room. Where's my assistant, Ms. Abramson? Could you please bring up a few flyers? Thank you, Ms. Abramson. I appreciate that. So there is the flyers.
Any possibility to get any letter or tape from the...
I don't have the means to do it in another way, like with cassettes or something. Well, I hope to publish a book on last week's lecture, but that will be several months from now, God willing. Also, as many of you know, my father's health is kind of precarious, and last semester I had to cancel a class. Thank you, Elisa. I had to cancel a class the last minute, and email is only one of the only ways that I can really, you know, broadcast a message out there to let you know there is not going to be a class. And so on. Okay, enough preliminaries. Let's go to the topic at hand. We're going to look at the life briefly of Nathan of Hanover, a rabbi who, as the name implies, has his origins in Germany, but his most significant contribution to Jewish history is a book he wrote in the context of the 17th century upheaval in Eastern Europe. In reality, this class is about that upheaval, and less about Nathan of Hanover, but since it is the derech, the approach of this class, to have a biographical kind of hook to the story, so therefore we're going to look at Nathan of Hanover specifically. As we mentioned last class, a surname that is geographic in origin is often misleading. And I wonder if one of my undergraduates would know why that is true. How about Ms. Edry? Do you know why a surname with a geographic location is misleading? That's a tough question. Don't make eye contact then, because it's always a killer. Okay, all right. Anyone else want to have a shot? Yes, Ms. Abramson, not an undergraduate, but nevertheless quite a scintillating intellect.
Because, let's say, your parents are from Canada, right?
My parents are from Canada, correct.
And then you moved to Surfside.
And then I moved to Surfside.
You're still called, like I would still be called Eliza of Canada.
Right.
No, I'm not from Canada, and my children would be called, my husband's children from his grandparents, and would go down the line until, like, your family has been, like, in a certain area for generations, but they're still going to be called from the other place.
Brilliant and absolutely precise. Thank you, Ms. Abramson, for that contribution. So let me repeat that again. Basically, you only get a surname with a place in among Jews, at any rate. It's common among other non-Jews as well, but you only get a surname that's a place long after you've left there, because people will refer to you by your origin only if it's unusual. No one would call you Moshe Surfside if you live in Surfside. They would call you Moshe Canada if you came from Canada to Surfside. So Nathan of Hanover lived in Ukraine. That's where most of his activity was. And he was most likely born in Ostry or Ostrog, Ukraine. But he was called of Hanover. Just as a small kind of note, my grandmother, Aleha Shalom, she used to tell me all kinds of stories about the bizarre nicknames that Jews in her shtetl would have. And my favorite nickname, it was a Yiddish culture to give everybody a nickname. My favorite was a guy whose name was Moshe Chayas. Moshe Chayas. That was Moshe, the one who belonged to Chaya. I mean, there were so many Moshes in town that there was Moshe der Schuster, Moshe der Handler. Moshe Chayas means Moshe, the one married to Chaya. So Moshe, who was of Chaya. Okay. So anyway, he was born in Ostry, Ukraine. Ukraine, as you can see in this map here, let's just locate this. It's in southwestern Russian Empire. The Ukrainians are a distinct nationality. They're Slavic. They have a language which is very closely related to Russian. It's written in Cyrillic, but with a different Cyrillic alphabet. There are several letters that are distinct between Russian and Ukrainian. And there has been a fairly long history of Russians wanting to try and assimilate Ukrainians to a larger Russian ethnicity. The Russians call themselves the Veliki Rossiyane, the big Russians, and they are the Malo Rossiyane, the small Russians. Russians, like the younger brothers, so to speak. Ukrainians, not surprisingly, tend to resist this and want to maintain their identity as separate from the Russians as a whole. Another major difference that's going to be relevant for our discussion today is that Russia is Eastern Orthodox in its Christian orientation. That means that they do not recognize the Pope. They recognize the Patriarchate of Moscow, and they have a lot of very big differences from Catholics. The most significant might include a married clergy, for example. Russian Orthodox priests can marry, and then there are a whole bunch of other doctrinal differences. Poles, on the other hand, are Catholics, recognizing the papacy in Rome and all of the rituals and beliefs associated with that. Ukraine, located between Poland and Russia, is split. The eastern half, a little bit more than eastern half, is Orthodox. The western half is Catholic. And it's a fissure in Ukrainian society that contributes to a lot of the internal dynamic of displeasure that occasionally results in weakened statehood, because the more Russified Ukrainians to the east want to join in some sense with Russia. The more Polonized Ukrainians to the west see Poland as their kind of center of orbit. And so it's a fractured country along the Dnipro River right over here, or Dnieper River in English. So that's where it is. It's also an exceptionally fertile area. It's known as the breadbasket of Europe because it has the Chernozem, the black soil that's extremely productive. And so it's fought over by many of the surrounding countries. We'll talk a little bit about Jews who come in there, but to return to our topic of Nathan of Hanover, although he was rather prolific, his most significant contribution to Jewish literature, and our reason for speaking about him today, is a very moving and sophisticated chronicle called Yeven Metsulah, which means it's translated fairly well into English as The Abyss of Despair. And it's a very powerful historical account of the Khmelnytsky rebellion and the pogroms. It's written with a remarkably high degree of sophistication for the 17th century. And although obviously it is a martyrology that describes the tremendous suffering the Jews went through, it does not spare the Jews in its assessment of their culpability for creating the scenario that would ultimately result in violence. So it's a rather even-handed account, surprisingly so, of the upheavals of that time. Okay, so why don't we take a step back here and understand how the Jews came to Ukraine. It was a very, very large population. If you look at the 20th century, it is, and looking at ethno-linguistic Ukraine, because Ukraine was not a country with its own state until really the Soviets took it over, and even then it was kind of a puppet state of Moscow. Ukraine had basically the second largest concentration of Jews in the world. It was a massive population of Jews living there. Most Jews who call themselves Russian Jews, if you probe a little further, they're really Ukrainian Jews. They come from the region of Kiev or western Ukraine, Zhytomyr, places like that. Although they may identify themselves as Russian, typically they are actually Ukrainian. So there are two reasons why Jews moved to Ukraine in large numbers from the 12th until the 17th centuries. And they're moving primarily from the Rhineland, from traditional Ashkenaz, and you've got significant populations moving from the south as well, from Austria and Hungary, until you have this massive concentration of Jews. Here's the Dnipro River that I showed you earlier that bisects Ukraine, and what was called right bank Ukraine, because when you're facing the flow of the Dnieper, it's on the right-hand side. Right bank Ukraine is heavily Jewish. It's, again, this is the Polish side, and it has huge populations here. To the left side, left bank Ukraine, this had very, very few Jews living there because the Russian government had banned Jews from settling in those regions from 1479. It's an unusual episode worth mentioning as a kind of a footnote. Jews were allowed to live in Russia up until the 15th century, when there was a scandal in the Russian imperial court involving a surprise conversion of a princess to Judaism. There was a Jewish doctor in the court whose name was Raphael, ironically, because Raphael means one who heals. This was known in Russian as a shanda for the Yidden, I guess. So what they did was the emperor said, that's it, no more Jews, and Russia, the Russian Empire, was declared officially Judenrein, free of Jews, banned to Jews, until Catherine the Great in the 18th century ended up conquering militarily this territory, and suddenly inheriting the world's largest Jewish population, even though up until the 18th century, no Jews were allowed there. So she gradually, and her successors gradually allowed Jews to settle to the west here, sorry, the east, places like Kharkov, also known as Kharkiv, or Yekaterinoslav, known as today as Dnipropetrovsk. People found that Yekaterinoslav was too hard to pronounce, so they switched it to Dnipropetrovsk. So now you have significant populations of Jews out there as well, but that's for another lecture when we get to the 20th century. Mr. Lax. Sir, avoid those body motions because then. Go ahead, please.
Could you possibly indicate what area was White Russia?
Mm-hmm. White Russia, now it's a confusing term because, White Russia is known in Russian as Belarus. Biela means like white. And it is to the north of Ukraine and to the east of Poland. It is Gesundheit. It's an even less well-defined political entity than Ukraine. And the Belarusians have difficulty as a people kind of defining where they live, who they are, how they're distinct from Poles, Ukrainians, and Russians, and so they tend to have the weakest kind of national identity. Their nationalism developed later than most of the other peoples in the region. So it's to the north of Ukraine and to the east of Poland here. Yes, Mark.
The actual political governance of areas like Ukraine and Belarus, I believe Ukraine at one time was subject to Poland.
Correct.
Polish Empire.
That's going to be our period today.
Was there ever a time before the 20th century when Ukraine was independent?
Well, there was a time going back to the very early medieval period, like the 8th, 9th, 10th centuries, where Kiev was the center of a medieval polity, which is called Kievan Rus. But to call that a state in modern terms would really be anachronistic. But they definitely had. Kiev was developed centuries before Moscow. It's called, Russians regard Kiev as the heartland of their state. But until the 20th century, really until the 19th century, no one's really thinking, we're Ukrainians distinct and separate from all the other peoples. We're related and so on. But let's go on. So I mentioned there are two reasons why Jews came to Ukraine. The first is because there is a dramatic rise in anti-Semitism in Western Europe. This is a picture that we discussed in the lecture on Pfefferkorn, the infamous Judensaal picture. This happens to be an 18th century rendition, but the image goes back to the 15th century with Jews suckling from pigs associated with the devil, torturing children, and so on. Jews were finding it harder and harder to just exercise normal commerce and live in Western European regions. From the 11th century on, you have the Crusades, the blood libel, ritual murder charges, frequent expulsions, increasing competition even in areas that had been reserved to them through the law of Gratian, such as money lending, and it's getting harder and harder for them to maintain a consistent existence in Western Europe from the 11th century onward. And so in France, for example, they're actually expelled, I think I mentioned last week, three times in one century. You know, the debts owed to Jewish moneylenders become too onerous, and so the Local authorities simply find it expedient to expel them and wipe out the debts. But when they wipe out, when they expel the Jews, then they totally lose their economic system and the whole institution of credit. So they have to invite the Jews back again. They invite the Jews 20 years later. There's too much of a debt load, and therefore they simply expel the Jews again. And the cycle repeated itself three times in France, just to give one example. So Jews are finding it far less hospitable to be in Western Europe, and as that door is closing, they're looking for an open door, which happens to fall in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. So this is a rather interesting country. Ah, Ms. Abramson, a question. I interrupt right away as soon as I see your hand.
Why did the Jews go back to France to expel beforehand?
Well, the question is, why would the Jews go back if they were expelled beforehand?
Why not?
I think it's a good question. Why not? I mean, you were expelled once, you could be expelled again. I guess it's kind of like a, it's like a bad marital relationship, you know. Why does she keep going back to him, you know? He's going to do the same thing over and over again. Not a very good answer, I guess, but I'm going to skip over next time you ask a question. We're going to go.
German Jews, they never like to live in Ukraine. They were always German. To have a chance to call back, they're going back. That's very
good. Okay, we'll see what's going on here. So the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth is rather unusual territory. It's so called because of a dynastic linkage between the royal homes of Poland and Lithuania. And through this marriage, it created literally the largest country in Europe. This massive country extending from the Baltic Sea almost down to the Black Sea here, encompassing all of what we would call today Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Belarus, and most of right bank Ukraine under this massive country that was nominally Catholic with Polish as the dominant language. It had an incredibly weak, primitive economy with tremendous freedoms for anyone who could come in and could start the economy moving, and so Jews were attracted to the potential of being there and working in that context. They were working as mintners and given tremendous freedom to act there. And they also had a strange kind of political system that allowed for high levels of diversity in society. I don't have time to go into it in great detail. It was ironically the great tolerance of diversity that led to the destruction of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, because their tolerance of dissent was to such a high level that they were literally paralyzed with indecision when faced with very serious threats. And when you get to the 18th century, the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth is simply removed from the map by its far more powerful and autocratic neighbors. It becomes, however, a haven for Jews from the 13th century onward, with an especially large wave of Jews moving in from Germany in the 16th and 17th centuries. And they like to refer to Poland at this time by the Hebrew acronym Polin, which means here we will rest. Poland was considered the place where, you know, finally the Jews can breathe a little bit. The levels of anti-Semitism that they experienced in Western Europe were nothing like this in Poland, and they had remarkable rights and freedoms and privileges. There were no ghettos in Poland. There were no, like, restricted areas. Jews had tremendous power and ability to organize their lives according to Talmudic principles and so on. I'll mention just one small example of this. A rather amazing thing. We'll come back to this when we talk about Szymon Dubnow, a 20th century historian later on in this course, was the so-called Wad Arba Aratzot, the Council of Four Lands. Because Jews would typically set up these little municipalities called kehilot. We use this word today too, as a kehila means a congregation. And they would set up their own judiciary, the Beit Din. They would set up their own executive branch, the Parnasim. They would have their own board of the city, the Tuve Yair. And they earned the right from the Polish-Lithuanian kings to judge themselves by Talmudic law exclusively. And many cases, even when they were in disputes with non-Jews, they earned the right to have their disputes adjudicated by Talmudic law. Now, that in itself is not so exceptional, because that's happened many times in Jewish history. What was unusual about the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth is that all of the municipalities in this massive region, about five times the size of France, simply decided that they would all agree and work together and create, literally, a state within a state, a Jewish government that ruled over all the Jews living in the entire Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. Well, they met two times a year in Lublin, and they adjudicated all kinds of disputes. They worked to take care of agunot, like women who were trapped in marriages after being abandoned by their husbands. They worked to effectively create copyright law, all kinds of fascinating things. And it was really a high point of Jewish civilization up until the 18th century. The collapse of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, however, also meant the collapse of the Council of Four Lands. And it came down in a rather dramatic way. So why were the Jews invited there in the first place? So primarily, they were invited because of the stratified nature of Polish society. The southern regions, which would be Ukraine, right bank Ukraine, had these massive farms called latifundia. And they were owned by the Polish noblemen who had won them through conquest, a long time earlier. And the Polish noblemen were living in the larger cities, Warsaw, places like that, and they were not especially inclined to take care of these huge landholdings. And so the Jews were invited to act as leaseholders. The Jews were invited to come and manage these massive tracts of land, which would include, as we discussed with Abravanel, tax farming, where the nobleman would say, okay, here's my tract of land. You Jewish community leaders, bring your people in and bring me X amount of zloty every year. And whatever the Jews were able to collect on top of that figure was theirs to keep in the community. In order to attract the Jews, they often gave them something that was called in medieval times Magdeburg Recht. Magdeburg is the name of a town in Germany. Recht, of course, is law. And these were charters that defined for the Jews what their rights and privileges were in a given town. And the Jews would literally, as an entire community, let's say living in Hanover, they would get an invitation to settle in Ostri, let's say, and the leaders of the community would negotiate, and they would say, okay, if you want us to live in Ostri, we're prepared to pick up and move, but one thing for sure, we want to have the right, for example, to say who is allowed to practice as a shoemaker in our town. And they could win that right. They would have the right to regulate commerce. They could say, we want to have the right, for example, to be judged only by Talmudic law. We want the right, for example, to build a wall around our town, which, you know, the walls were usually built not to keep the Jews in, but to keep attackers out. And they could arrange all kinds of privileges through Magdeburg Recht, and the Poles were only too happy to give it to them because they wanted the Jews to move in and help out this nascent economy get started. So with these two things happening, the push of anti-Semitism from Western Europe driving the Jews out, and the economy vacuum in Poland sucking the Jews in, it was like really a beautiful thing for Jews, and for 300 years they made a series of ladder migrations deep into Ukrainian territory. This is, for example, by the way, this is an early 16th century Christian manuscript that has a little drawing of a wooden synagogue in the background. Oh, I should show you some wooden synagogues. I'll show it another time, but okay, yes.
I have to mention Poland has a lot of resources in very, very rich country, so they didn't know what they're doing. They invited the Jews, they established all around all the industrial, from textile to the iron, everything.
Right.
They lift up unbelievable value for Poland.
That's what I'm going to get specifically to that now.
See it now they confess it.
Yeah. I'm going to try and move along because I have to get to Khmelnytsky. That's right. I want to go to Khmelnytsky. Yeah, last question, then we better move on right away.
I believe one of the Polish kings invited the Jews.
Yes.
Casimir,
also Boleslaw. We have repeated requests from the Jews. There's all kinds of interesting legends about their association with Jews and so on.
Their economy, to say the least.
Yeah. Now, the backbone of the Jewish economy was something called the arenda, and this will be very significant for understanding the upheaval of the 18th century. The arrenda is the name for the system of leaseholding of these large landed properties, where you have a remember, the ethnicities are important here. You have a Polish nobleman who is the owner, and he literally owns everything. He owns the streets, he owns the orchards, he owns the mills, like the mills for grain, he owns the water wheels, he owns the fields, he owns the ponds for fishing, the hunting grounds. It all belongs to him, and he can do whatever he wants with it. He has peasants who he also owns. The institution of serfdom was well entrenched. Serfdom is not exactly like slavery, because serfs are technically free. The only thing is that freedom is seriously compromised. They may not leave. They may not marry without the owner's permission. And they are required to do a certain amount of work for the Lord, which can either be something called corvée, which is a certain amount of forced labor. So for example, if you have a six-day work week, they may be required to go to the farms belonging to the Lord, and they'll have to work 2 days a week on the Lord's farms, and they'll rotate that out. And the other 4 days will be theirs to work on their own field. Or later, they to switch to something called barshchina, where they would actually pay a fixed rent for the privilege of living on the land. But it's not exactly the same as slavery, where they're watched every minute and things like that. Still, it's not a nice situation at all. The Jew and those peasants are overwhelmingly Ukrainian. You have the Polish lord, the Ukrainian peasant, and the Jew is the one who's negotiating between these two groups. As I mentioned, tax farming was the backbone of the arrenda, where the nobleman would say, I want my farm to produce so much money per year, collect it any way you see fit, and I will support you in your efforts. The means that Jews devised to collect that tax was often quite onerous. Obviously, there's a tax on agricultural produce, but also the Jews would impose taxes on tolls, crossing bridges, traveling through roads, for example, using the mill or the press. If you wanted to press grapes, if you wanted to grind your wheat, you would have to pay a tax for that. And a portion of that tax would go to the Jew, and the rest would be for the Lord. Hunting or fishing, you know, it would be poaching, unless you paid the Jew for your catch and so on. And according to some really controversial passages, which have been confirmed in a small minority of cases by recent research done at Hebrew University, Jews even sometimes held the keys to churches. And so if you wanted to have your child baptized, or if you wanted to have a wedding, you would have to go get the key from the Jew, which often required a payment. Now, the number of times this happened is probably very, very minimal, because you can imagine the level of antipathy that could be developed when, you know, you have to go to the Jew to get the keys to the church. But it looms very large in the Ukrainian consciousness. At this point, the Ukrainians are basically illiterate. They do have a long-standing literary tradition from the ancient period, or the late medieval period, where they have important books like the Povest Vremennych Let, the Tale of Bygone Years, which is not really in Russian, it's in Church Slavonic, which reminds me of a funny story. I actually know a funny story about Church Slavonic, but I'll have to tell it when I'm off mic, because it's a little dirty. But I lost my train of thought. Oh yeah, but they're basically illiterate at this point. What they have as a literary tradition are oral stories sung by these blind guitarists called banduristen, who would wander from town to town. It's an old motif. Homer was like that in the Greeks and so on. And they would tell these long, complicated poems set to music that were the histories of the Ukrainians. And they're called dume, these songs. And over again, Jews figure as these wicked people who are denying families the rights to use their own churches. So even though it may be only a tiny minority of times that this actually occurred, it nevertheless was a big part of the Ukrainian perception of the Jew. So you can imagine this is not necessarily a way to make friends in your new neighborhood. add to that another industry that was very popular for Jews, it's called propinatia, which I may have mentioned in an earlier class. Propinatia refers to the monopoly assigned to the Jews by the noblemen for the production, distribution, and sale of alcohol. Jews have a long history with this industry. A lot of the big distillers today and distributors today are Jews. I don't know, and certainly not a majority, but significantly. Like, for example, there's that guy, what's his name? Glenn Levitt, I think. No, okay, that's a joke, but okay. No, anyways, not so funny. But so the Jews would be given the right to have the exclusive privilege of producing alcohol and selling alcohol. And you got to remember that the vast majority, close to 98% of Ukrainians, are farmers, peasants. And the figure is just about reversed for Jews. Only about 2% of Jews are farmers. Most of them are living in the northern Hungarian region of Sighet, Maramures, and they're primarily dairymen too. Like Tevye was a dairyman. Jews are just not big into farming for lots of reasons that I won't go into right now. But one big industry for Jews was maintaining inns. You know, you travel along the road, stop at an inn, on your way home from the fields, and you'd have a few drinks. And the bartender would be Jewish, and the alcohol is produced by Jews, so every encounter you have with this perhaps less salient aspect of modern society would be Jewish. You combine that with the fact that you could often run up a tab, where during the years when, you know, you're farming, but all your produce is still in the ground, so you say, I'll pay you in harvest season, and the bartender can say, sure, I'll put it on your tab. Then when you get to the end of the season and you get your harvest, and all of a sudden you realize you drank a good portion of your harvest through the work year, that's certainly going to generate another higher level of animosity as well. That's not to say that Jews were only involved in these nasty kind of trades. These are the trades that, you know, were perhaps largest in the Ukrainian imagination, but Jews were engaged in all kinds of small level commerce. And in fact, when you get to the end of the 19th century, Jews in this region were heavily impoverished as well. Very reliable demographic studies indicate that as close to 20% of the population of Jews were so-called Luftmenschen, which means they lived on air, that there was they had no discernible means of support, and somehow they're just living off tzedakah, off charity that's somehow coming their way. So we're not talking about a hugely wealthy population. We're talking about, well, let's not go there. So Jews were involved very heavily in all kinds of crafts as well. Silversmithing was very big. Typically, small kinds of trades that Jews could peddle from farmstead to farmstead. Spoons, cutlery, shoes. Later in the 19th century, textiles would become a huge Jewish industry, especially with the advent of industrialization and the availability of sewing machines. You remember the scene in Fiddler on the Roof where the tailor Mutl Kamzoil gets a sewing machine, and that represents a huge breakthrough for his family economically. It really was like that. So Jews very big into a lot of crafts. Another fascinating area of Jewish work is music. Again, you have to think about what we're dealing with in terms of the lifestyle of these people. The Ukrainian peasants, dawn, they're out, they got to be in the fields, backbreaking work, weeding, hoeing, plowing, sewing. Sun starts to go down. You know, they don't have the energy for intellectual activities. They barely have energy for any kind of cultural activities. So the music of this region is overwhelmingly Jewish. Specifically, a style of music called klezmer, which comes from the Hebrew terms klei zemer, vessels of song or instruments of song. And the klezmer musicians, typically they're only playing with instruments that can be carried, because it's very hard to run with a piano. But, you know, violins, snare drums, clarinets, woodwinds, things like that. Later on, bass, guitar, things like that. And they're essentially taking a lot of like folk Ukrainian melodies, transferring them through typically a minor key into a Jewish sort of mindset, and this becomes Eastern European music. It's a beautiful genre that crosses many ethnicities. And we are lucky, by the way, here in South Florida to have one of the most amazing klezmer musicians in the world, my colleague Aaron Kula. His brother actually lives here in Surfside, and he puts on this concert every year at Florida Atlantic University for 3,000 people, and it's sold out months in advance. Beautiful modern klezmer. But at any rate, this is also a Jewish occupation. Let us turn, however, to the upheaval, which is, of course, the main topic that we're getting to 45 minutes into it. It's important to understand that this particular region, because of its ethnic complexity, typically involves triangular conflicts. It's never the Ukrainians versus the Jews, or the Poles versus the Jews, or the Russians versus the Jews. Although the versus the Jews part is pretty much common. The fact is there's usually more than one ethnicity involved, and it's a complicated conflict that can only be understood when you look at the dynamics of the whole picture. In the period that we're looking at right now, the nature of the arenda system placed the Jews as the leading edge of the hammer with which the Poles beat the Ukrainians. The Jews did not create the system, but they definitely were part of the system. And when the Ukrainians ultimately rose up in rebellion, as they did, with tremendous ferocity and brutality in the middle of the 17th century, the Jews felt the brunt of that anger even more than the Poles. If you'll consider by analogy, if you remember the riots in Los Angeles over the beating of Rodney King, and that was, you know, horrible. Los Angeles was burning for days and days as blacks were, you know, understandably upset with this instance of police brutality. The people who hurt the most were the Koreans, who were the only ethnicity that was willing to set up shops in these, you know, more dangerous perhaps areas of South Central Los Angeles. And so although the rage of the African American population was really directed at the white establishment, the Koreans were much closer and much easier to attack. So too we find in Ukraine that when the Ukrainians, you know, want to throw off what they see as Polish oppression, the Jews are close by. And the Jews are the instrument of that oppression that they can reach easily, and of course the Jews suffer terribly. This pattern will be repeated throughout the next few centuries, including even in the Nazi period, which we will discuss, God willing, later on this year. So this culminates in what is known in Hebrew historiography as Gzeras Tach V'Tat. Gzera means evil decree, and Tach V'Tat are the Hebrew acronyms of the years 1648 and 1649, which is when the pogroms were at their worst. Many Kabbalists believe that 1648 would actually be the year of the arrival of the Messiah. We see that as a recurring theme in Jewish history, and they could not be much further away from the truth. The revolt, when it happened, as you can imagine, had several key factors. The first was economic. The Ukrainians were tired of several centuries of increasingly exorbitant taxes they had to pay to the Polish nobility. They were also cultural, because the main source of this rebellion came from eastern Ukraine, the southern region of the Dnieper River, where the Ukrainians were much more Orthodox, and they viewed the Poles as trying to Polonize them, to pull them away from the Russian orbit that they felt much closer to. Poles are also a Slavic people, but as I mentioned, they're Catholic, and they write their language with the Roman alphabet. Ukrainians in the region where this rebellion started were Orthodox, writing with the Cyrillic alphabet, even though the languages are very closely related. Usually Ukrainians can sort of understand Polish and vice versa. I remember one of the best compliments I ever got when I was studying in Ukraine many years ago is I went to buy something at an outdoor market, and this old peasant woman looked at me funny and she said, "You have an accent. You're not from around here. Where are you from? Poland?" I thought, wow, that's great. Okay. So the Jews, though, were essentially, and finally, religious, because the Poles really wanted to the Ukrainians become Catholic. And they put great pressure on the Orthodox Poles to convert to Catholicism. And in fact, a new church was created called the Uniate Church, which still exists to this day. And it's very popular among Ukrainians in America, primarily because that's where the migration came to in this country, which was a Catholic church, which the Pope recognized as having primarily Orthodox ritual. So they look like Orthodox, they have similar kind of communion and things like that, and they even are allowed under some circumstances to marry, but they owe their allegiance to Rome rather than to the Patriarchate in Moscow. So the Ukrainians rose up under the leadership of a man named Bohdan Khmelnytsky. Here's how you may see his name spelled in a lot of English language work, and it's also another very difficult one to spell. Chmielnicki, it's completely wrong. This is just the way it's written in Polish, and if you understand Polish phonetics, you'll know that it's pronounced Chmielnicki, which is also not so easy to pronounce, but that's not our job at any rate. Chmielnicki brought together a band of outliers in Ukrainian society, the so-called kozake, or Cossacks. These were people who were like runaway serfs. They were living as bandits, mainly attacking Turkish ports on the Black Sea, living outside the boundaries of official society. They were not typically part of any given noble landholding, latifundia, and they were like outlaws. They were, in the Ukrainian mind, like cowboys of the Wild West, living on their own, you know. And it's ironic, it is strange that, you know, when you get into the Ukrainian Weltanschauung, the Ukrainian worldview, the Cossacks are like the heroes. They're like bold, independent spirits. They're, you know, freedom fighters. The Cossacks are quite literally heroes to the Ukrainians. And for Jews, they are like anathema. They're horrible villains. And one of the reasons why Ukrainians and Jews often have difficulty communicating with each other is because they don't even have the same vocabulary to describe how they feel about these groups. But not enough, we won't say any more about that. Here's a picture by the famous artist Ilya Repin, who shows the that shows the Cossacks in their home base, the Sich, which was located in the rapids of the Dnieper River. And you can see that they wear these Turkish-style haircuts with the top knot and the long drooping mustache. That was kind of like the style. And they're laughing at a letter that they're writing to the Tsar. They're kind of like devil may care, recognize no authority kind of people. So when they finally rose up under Khmelnytsky against the Polish landholdings, they essentially moved their way from shtetl to shtetl, making their way up to the northwest and northeast, northwest, up to the Polish, the main area of Polish settlement, and along the way committing absolutely horrific atrocities along the way. At this point, I'll pause to speak about what these atrocities were, but we have a little bit of time, so I can take a question or two. Nobody has a question, so maybe I'll drink a little bit of coffee. Okay, so what is a pogrom? The term pogrom is of Russian origin, and it's unclear exactly what the root of this term means. It indicates a quasi-military attack on a civilian population. Although it was not used exclusively for Jews in the first few hundred years of its existence, and it was used interchangeably with terms like riot and insurrection, by the time you get to the 20th century, and especially the horrible pogroms of 1919, this becomes basically a Jewish word. Jews suffer pogroms. There were definitely other populations that suffered pogroms as well, but it's kind of like the word Holocaust that is specifically directed at Jews, and that's how people understand it now. The Jews, as they saw this wide-scale peasant uprising, which, by the way, was only one of several major uprisings that occurred in Europe in this terrible century, the Jews saw their allies as the Poles. They saw the Poles as their employers, and typically, historically, the Poles had supported them whenever they had any minor dispute with the Ukrainian peasantry, and so they went to the Poles hoping to receive some succor and some aid. And quite often they received it, but more often than not, the Poles would betray them to the Ukrainians, hoping that the Ukrainians would vent their anger on the Jews rather than express their violence against the Poles. And they literally marched from shtetl to shtetl. We have to remember that the Jews are living in really well-defined, discrete numbers in villages, easily found, easily attacked, not like farmsteads way out in the middle of nowhere. They're on the main roads. They have really no place to go, no escape whatsoever. I'm not going to tell you some of the horrific stories that Hanover writes of in Yeven Metsulah, but they are really very, very chilling graphic displays of specific massacres that are confirmed by other accounts of the region as well. One area, though, that does deserve a little more attention is the scope of these massacres. Hanover's figures are undoubtedly inflated. And it gets even worse when you go to the 20th century. And many historians have estimated as many as 250,000 Jews dying in these pogroms. That number is certainly far larger than the reality. It's probably closer to 50 or 60,000 deaths, which is a huge number for the 17th century. If you look by comparison, the infamous pogroms of the 1880s that ultimately brought down the Russian Empire, ultimately created a huge wave of immigration to America. Only 84 Jews were killed in 4 years of pogroms during the 1880s, and those loom large in the Jewish memory. So 50,000 is a huge number. However, very good demographic analysis indicates that there probably weren't anywhere close to 250,000 Jews living there at the time of the pogroms. And then if you look at the bounce back of the demographic after the pogroms, the Jews replaced themselves so rapidly that the numbers are most likely inflated. Nevertheless, it had a huge impact on the Jewish mind and Jewish memory, figures in the Tisha B'Av liturgy and so on. Mm-hmm. To give you, let me just say one more thing about this picture. This is a picture from, this is in Kiev. Площадь Незалежність, which is the Independence Square now, right in the center of it. Right, they have here. This is a statue of Khmelnytsky, and he's riding on this horse that's raised up, and he's facing towards Moscow, because ultimately what happens to Khmelnytsky is he defeats the Poles, and then he immediately joins Moscow, which made him very unpopular with some later Ukrainians who felt that he defaulted by giving up Ukrainian statehood when they were, just about to grab it. But at any rate, in the original bronze casting of this statue, it had a Jew under the hoof of the horse. Even the Tsar felt that was in poor taste, so when they put up this heroic statue of Khmelnytsky, they decided to remove the downtrodden Jew. Now, what is the result of the Khmelnytsky rebellion? Well, it definitely had a colossal impact on Jewish thinking, comparable to the Spanish expulsion. One might say comparable even to the Holocaust in how Jews thought of the reality of living in the diaspora. We see it show up in the Tisha B'Av liturgy, in the liturgy of the 3 weeks, and really up until the 20th century, there were communities in Eastern Europe who had fast days that were put in their calendar remembering massacres from the 17th century. And many historians, beginning with Heinrich Gretz in the 19th century, argue that the huge disappointment, the anticipation of the Messianic period, which was then replaced by these horrible pogroms, created a kind of a lassitude and an intellectual despair among Eastern European Jewry that later resulted in the widespread enthusiasm for Shabbatai Tzvi, the false messiah, and there's some good argument for that. Shabbatai Tzvi, his greatest period is in the early 1660s, so it's 10 years after the pogroms. Some would say that, like Gretz, for example, who felt that Hasidism was a primitive superstitionist movement, he felt that Hasidism really was a result of the Khmelnytsky rebellion because Jews were just so full of despair that they latched onto Kabbalah and mysticism as a solace for understanding their problems. Other historians disagree and say that the connections between these events are highly tendentious, but there's no question that Khmelnytsky and the rebellion looms large in the Jewish imagination. We should return by way of conclusion to Nathan of Hanover, who had survived, of course, the pogroms and went on to collect a large number of other chronicles that were prepared by other survivors and put them together in this book, Yeven Metsulah, which is available in English, a very fine translation by Abraham Mish. As I mentioned, the title is Abyss of Despair. His father was murdered in, I believe it was 1649, and so he began a period of wandering where he engaged in various rabbinic positions, first in Germany, then Holland, Italy, and finally Moravia. He was really quite prolific. Perhaps his most famous religious work is called Shari Tzion, which is a Kabbalistic prayer book still in use today in many congregations, and an interesting book called the Safa Barura, which was very, very useful for the Jewish refugees, which was a quadrilingual dictionary. Using a basic dictionary vocabulary with words in Hebrew and their translations into Yiddish, Italian, and Latin. Later, after his death, it was updated to include French as well. Very, very valuable book because it allowed Jews who were traveling or were displaced to find a way to communicate. Ultimately, in the context of the Turkish-Austrian War, he got caught up in the violence of that war, and he died as a result of a riot in 1683. But his key work, the Yeven Metsulah, is something that really gives us a very powerful and gripping account of the Khmelnytsky rebellion, and it is a rather even-handed and remarkably sophisticated work of historiography for the 17th century. Okay, with that, I want to thank you very much for your attention and endurance. And next week, we're going to Western Europe. We'll talk about Moses Mendelssohn, the beginnings of the Reform movement, the Haskalah, and so on. Thank you once again. You're not going to tell the